Okay, and the next item of business is a statement by John Swinney on Scotland's redress scheme. The Deputy First Minister will take questions at the end of his statement. Therefore, there should be no interventions or interruptions. And I call on Mr Swinney for around 10 minutes, Deputy First Minister.
President Officer, as a Parliament, we have pledged to keep the promise that all of Scotland's children grow up loved, safe and respected. But a rightly ambitious future should not obscure the need to shine light into the darkness where it has existed in the past. On March 11th this year, this Parliament unanimously passed the Redress for Survivors, Historical Child Abuse in Care Scotland Act 2021. I said then that this was one of the most important pieces of legislation that the Scottish Parliament would consider in its lifetime, and I gave a commitment that Scotland's redress scheme would open for applications by the end of this year. Today, we are honouring that commitment and opening the scheme. From this afternoon, survivors of historical child abuse in care can apply for the redress they deserve, a redress package that includes a payment of between £10,000 and £100,000 and access to support and apology. In some circumstances, next of kin can also apply for a redress payment of £10,000. Across party lines, we have come together to confront the scale and the horror of the abuse Scotland's vulnerable children suffered. We cannot make up for that pain, and we cannot take away the devastating impact it has had on people's lives. But we can, from today, provide acknowledgement and tangible recognition of the harm caused by offering redress to survivors through Scotland's redress scheme. As a nation, we are taking this step together to acknowledge and address the injustices of the past. I hope that survivors and the families of those who are no longer with us, whose tenacity and determination have led us to this milestone, can feel a sense of justice today. Out of the horror they endured, the silence they were forced to keep in childhood and beyond, they fought for recognition. Part of that recognition is delivered today by this scheme. In September this year, Lady Smith, Chair of the Scottish Child Abuse Inquiry, said that for far too long, survivors' voices were not listened to nor heard. They were treated as if their views did not matter and as if they were not worth listening to, just as they were when they were abused in care. We accept that the steps taken by government to respond to survivors between 2002 and 2014, a period which spanned different administrations, happened too slowly and did not go far enough. During that period, a significant number of survivors of childhood abuse in care in Scotland died. Lady Smith said that for them, justice delayed was justice denied. Today, the Scottish Government apologises unreservedly that it did not respond more appropriately and sooner to the concerns of survivors of abuse in care who called for a public inquiry. We apologise to the families of those survivors who died before the inquiry began its work and before the redress scheme opened. We know many survivors are advancing in age and see their health decline. That is why we launched the advanced payment scheme in April 2019, which has now made payments to over 700 survivors. That too is why we have worked as hard as we could to open the scheme as soon as possible after the legislation passed. The scheme will be delivered by the Scottish Government, who will be the main point of contact for applicants, and by Redress Scotland, the new independent body which will make decisions on eligibility and levels of redress payments to be offered to applicants. Everyone involved in both organisations carries with them a commitment to ensuring those who apply to the scheme will be treated with dignity, respect and compassion. These three principles will be the hallmark of Scotland's redress scheme. I invite all survivors who are eligible for the scheme to consider applying if it is the right choice for them. That is a personal choice, and there is funding for independent legal advice to help survivors make the right choice for them. Support is available at every stage of the application process. Caseworkers in the Scottish Government have been carefully recruited and understand that applying for redress is not an administrative task. It will, for some, be deeply emotional as they come to terms with their childhood and navigate the sensitivity in disclosing to others what they endured. Caseworkers will offer help on how to obtain supporting documents. They will give advice on completing the application form and answer any questions that applicants may have. We recognise that some people may decide they need additional emotional support or feel they would benefit from additional practical support, such as specialist help to access records. In these circumstances, caseworkers will be able to refer applicants to the Redress Support Service, a new bespoke service which can provide access to external specialist services using existing networks developed by the InCare Survivors Alliance. We also recognise that some applicants will want the independent support of a solicitor of their choosing. The Redress scheme will pay fees for a solicitor to support applicants with their application. There has been a strong survivor voice throughout the process of designing and developing the scheme, and I extend my sincere thanks to all survivors who have contributed their time, commitment and insight. Their input has been crucial in so many aspects, including developing the service, testing application forms and other materials, and helping in the selection of panel members for Redress Scotland. The first 20 panel members for Redress Scotland have been appointed through the public appointments process and come from a range of diverse backgrounds. Each panel member has undergone training to build on their experience and to apply it to Redress. A huge volume of work has been undertaken at pace to open for applications today. As the scheme becomes established in the weeks and the months ahead, we will continue to work with survivors, listening and responding to the experience of applications and refining and improving how the scheme operates. A new survivor forum will be established early next year to ensure that applicants have a mechanism through which to continue to provide feedback and to make recommendations for improvements. There have been a number of opportunities for survivors to contribute their thoughts and ideas on shaping the survivor forum, including through workshops and a questionnaire. Everyone who applies to the Redress scheme can, if they wish, become a member of the survivor forum. It will be inclusive and accessible to all, offering a range of ways to participate. The scheme will be open for at least 5 years, and we will ensure that we raise awareness among survivors and their families so that as many as possible who are eligible have the opportunity to apply. This will build on the work we have done to involve and engage survivors so far, and on the learning gained and connections established with relevant organisations and survivors through the advance payment scheme. As of today, the advance payment scheme will close to new applications. Applications already received to the advance payment scheme will continue to be processed. Organisations that were responsible for the care of children at the time of the abuse have been asked to participate in Scotland's Redress scheme and to make fair and meaningful financial contributions to redress payments for survivors. This is what survivors have told us in successive consultations that they want. Those with a responsibility for the failings of the past have a responsibility to do the right thing today. This is a national endeavour, and it is morally imperative that collectively we join together to believe and support those who were not believed and not supported in the past. The statement of principles according to which fair and meaningful contributions are assessed was published last week in preparation for launch. I welcome those organisations on the list of scheme contributors, which is published on the government website today, and those who are finalising participation and will join imminently. Discussions with other organisations continue. I am confident more will follow in addressing their legacy by joining our collective response in the days and the weeks ahead. Presiding Officer, the Redress scheme is now open. Those who want to find out more can find application forms and guidance online at mygov.scot/redress. From 10 o'clock tomorrow morning, phone lines will open for those who would like hard copy application packs posted to them. They can call 0808 175 0808 for survivor applications or 0808 281 7777 for next of kin applications. A team of specially trained caseworkers working on behalf of the Scottish Government stand ready to help all applicants at each stage of the application process. The lines will be open from 10 a.m. until 4 p.m. Monday to Thursday up until the 21st of December, when we will close the lines for the Christmas and New Year break and reopen on the 5th of January. Finally, Presiding Officer, when I announced in the Scottish Parliament that there would be a financial redress scheme, I also offered an unreserved apology on behalf of the Scottish Government to everyone who suffered abuse in care in Scotland. Today, I reiterate that apology to survivors and their families. While we know we cannot fully make up for the harm that was done and for our failure to take action sooner, we hope this acknowledgement goes some way to redressing those wrongs. Survivors of childhood abuse have had to endure unbearable pain. Today, as a country, by opening this redress scheme, we take a further step in addressing that suffering in the hope that our actions now begin to address the failings of the past.
Thank you very much, Deputy First Minister. The Deputy First Minister will now take questions on the issues raised in his statement. I intend to allow around 20 minutes for questions, after which we will need to move to the next item of business. I would be grateful if members who wish to ask a question could press the request to speak buttons now or as soon as possible, or place an R in the chat function. And I call on Jamie Green.
Thank you. Can I thank the Deputy First Minister for advance sight of the statement and add my absolute support that we, as he mentioned, on a cross-party basis, remain committed to the ongoing success of the redress scheme as it opens, an issue which rightly brought us together as a Parliament, and legislation which I am proud to have played my own small part in meaningfully. There is much to welcome in the statement, which I think reflects the calls and asks of the survivor community. Next of kin payments, funding independent legal advice, the promise of the Survivors Forum, and a commitment to those underlying principles of dignity, respect and compassion. But more importantly, a reiteration of that apology, one which I add the voice of these benches to as well. But let me ask a few specific questions to the Deputy First Minister, which I feel were not addressed today. Can I ask what forecasting has taken place regarding the potential scale and volume of the levels of financial redress which may be sought and indeed paid out, given that the Government will underwrite the majority of the low-band payments? Of those who have committed, those organisations who rightly should participate, what level of funding has been committed by them to ensure that they do actually pay a fair and meaningful share of redress? And may I ask who, or indeed how many, have failed to rise to the occasion and shamefully refused to participate in the scheme? Lastly, can I ask more about the nature of local authority participation? Because many will be wondering the effect that this might have on them. What discussions have taken place with local authorities about their participation in the scheme so that they can meaningfully participate in it, but do the right thing without jeopardising their ability to provide vital services to young people today in our communities?
Deputy First Minister.
I thank Mr Green for his questions and acknowledge the enormously helpful role he played in the passage of this legislation through Parliament earlier on in the last parliamentary session, which I think was appreciated certainly by me and by all Members of Parliament. In relation to his specific questions on forecasting, we haven't changed our position from the material set out in the financial memorandum for the bill, which gave estimates, which by their nature will always be rough estimates of the volume of investment that will be required. But he is correct that the financial approach is that we will pursue contributions from organisations, but the Government expects to make a substantial financial contribution over a number of years to this scheme. In relation to the contributions achieved to date, over £115 million has been committed to the scheme, £100 million of which is coming from Scottish local authorities, and I welcome the contribution that local authorities are prepared to make to the scheme. The list of contributors is published on the Government's website today. We will continue to update that because there are a number of different examples that are specifically being negotiated at this present time, so I expect that list to change and develop over time. Some organisations, I think, will have waited to see this getting off the ground and to see others being prepared to take the decisions to contribute. And I thank those who have made that contribution already and obviously will pursue those further discussions with individual parties. In terms of the impact on local authorities have been very constructive about this issue in their discussions, and we have come to an agreement that the local authority contribution will essentially be top slice from the government's contribution to local authority funding over a number of years to spread that burden appropriately. Mr Green makes a very valid point, which he will know from the legislation was an issue we wrestled with at length in the legislative process, that we must take care, and this is where the thinking around fair and meaningful contributions comes in, to ensure that whilst we pursue legitimate contributions for the past, we do not jeopardise the ability of organisations to provide vital service upon which young people depend today. And that sensitive balance will be applied by the government.
Michael Mara.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and thank you to the Deputy First Minister for an advance sight of his statement. I'd like to associate these benches and the Labour Party with his eloquent and heartfelt words and reiterate the importance of the apology that has just been made. I hope that survivors may now feel, in part even, that they have been listened to and that they have been heard. Today marks welcome progress in redressing the abuse that survivors have suffered, and that the scheme is now operational is welcome news indeed. What actions are being taken by the government to further publicise the scheme to ensure maximum participation?
Deputy First Minister.
I thank Mr Mara for his comments, and I think he is right to characterise this in the hope that survivors will feel listened to at this stage. And obviously, I've placed on the record the if my memory serves me correct, to Polly McNeill when I answered an urgent question on this point some weeks ago. The report from Lady Smith and the paragraph that I quoted is one of the most uncomfortable paragraphs that I've had to respond to in terms of being written about government. And I hope survivors feel that we are now properly addressing the issues that they have raised. In connection with the issue of publicising the scheme, there is an awareness campaign that will be rolled out as part of the launch of the scheme to maximise the understanding and the awareness of the existence of the scheme. I'm heartened that we had 700 applications in the advance payment scheme. That suggests to me that word was able to get out, because obviously the advance payment scheme was only available to a limited proportion of the survivor community. The fact that we had 700 applications that were successful gives me hope that we can get the messages out, but obviously we will put a great deal of effort into ensuring that, and I would invite Members of Parliament to support us in that endeavour as well, because it is vital that individuals are aware of this and that they make applications as appropriately.
Claire Adamson, to be followed by Megan Gallagher.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Thank you, Deputy First Minister, for your statement, not just for its content marking the milestones in the Redress Scotland applications, but also to reiterate that all-important apology to victims of historic child abuse. But what measures and reassurance can you give to historic child abuse victims that they will be treated with dignity, respect and compassion throughout the application process?
Deputy First Minister.
Presiding Officer, I'm not in any way surprised that that is the question that Claire Adamson puts to me, because it was an amendment from Claire Adamson in her capacity as the convener of the Education and Skills Committee in the last Parliament that inserted the words dignity, respect and compassion into the legislation as part of the founding principles of Redress Scotland and the Redress Scotland scheme. And I said at the time that that was an important addition to the bill, because essentially it gets us off in establishing the scheme on exactly the right footing, whereby every individual will be treated with dignity, respect and compassion. I had the pleasure a couple of weeks ago to meet with, it actually may have only been last week actually now that I think about it, to meet with the staff who will be administering this scheme. And I was making the point to them that from the first moment a phone is answered in a government office, which is a call made by a survivor, that survivor must feel dignity, respect and compassion in the answering of that phone call. And that is and I know, having spoken to the members of staff, I know how committed they are to this work. They view it as an important task I've set out the importance the government attaches to this being done properly, aided by the wording that Claire Adamson inserted into the legislation to ensure that we have the right values and ethos underpinning the scheme, and I am confident that will be applied by our staff.
Megan Gallagher, to be followed by Rona Mackay.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Deputy First Minister's previous update on the scheme in June set out that 25% of applications to the advance payment scheme had been rejected. How will the government continue to support survivors who struggle to access the appropriate records? And does the Deputy First Minister expect this rate of rejected applications will continue?
Deputy First Minister.
The issues that we've wrestled with in the advance payment scheme are slightly different simply because of the eligibility criteria that were involved in that scheme. I would assure Megan Gallagher and Parliament that we will be supporting individuals in the accessing of records, because I recognise that to be a significant and potentially very stressful experience for individuals, to minimise the risk of records availability being an obstacle to individuals being able to access the scheme. So that support will be there. There will also be wider wellbeing support, which is available through a number of channels. I recounted a number in my statement, to make sure that we recognise that individuals may need support which is not financial support to enable them to navigate their way through what I recognise to be a very challenging period for them.
Rona Mackay, to be followed by Katie Clark.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Deputy First Minister what legal advice will be available to applicants going through the process.
Deputy First Minister.
Presiding Officer, applicants will be able to obtain independent legal advice. We've set out the framework basis on which that will be available to enable individuals to be able to make a judgment about the scheme. As I've indicated in my statement, and it was an issue we wrestled with at length during the legislative process, this scheme is not for everybody. This scheme may not be appropriate for certain people, but individuals must be able to make an informed judgment about whether that is the case or not, and that's an important part of the availability of legal advice.
Katie Clark, to be followed by Audrey Nicholl.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And I welcome this statement, and in particular, the apologies that have been made by the Scottish Government to survivors. Does the Deputy First Minister agree that for many, the additional practical and emotional support will be even more important than any financial compensation? And could he outline what work is being done to establish the Redress Support Service, how much it's likely to cost, but also how we can ensure that it's properly resourced?
Deputy First Minister.
I accept the point that Katie Clark makes to me, that for many individuals, it will be the surrounding support, which is just as important, in some circumstances possibly more important, than the financial support available. I hope this move today is viewed by survivors as another means of helping to try to address their suffering. And if I don't for a moment believe that financial compensation does that, if the wider support can do that, then we will have helped people in a way that is meaningful. Those services need to be supported financially on an ongoing basis. The government has a range of schemes available. I don't have the sum of money to hand with me, but I'll confirm it to Katie Clark in writing. But we do have a range of financial support schemes that are financially supported, where individuals are able to access that support, and they are able to get assistance in coming to terms with their suffering, and the government's given a long-term commitment to those endeavours.
Audrey Nicholl, to be followed by Beatrice Wishart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Deputy First Minister what steps the Scottish Government have taken to ensure the waiver scheme is fair.
Deputy First Minister.
Presiding Officer, the waiver scheme is a sensitive part of the scheme, and it was sensitive during the passage of the legislation. But it is in the Government's view, and ultimately in Parliament's view, the right measure to enable us to secure contributions. We obviously have to make sure that when individuals are making applications, they are doing so with a full knowledge and a full understanding of the issues that they with which they have to wrestle. So the taking of independent legal advice is crucial in equipping individuals with the ability to make a judgment as to whether this scheme is appropriate for them and whether the waiver is appropriate for them to sign.
Beatrice Wishart to be followed by James Dornan.
I'm pleased that the Scotland's redress scheme has been established so quickly since the passing of the historic legislation at the end of last session. And I also want to acknowledge the Deputy First Minister's apology, which he has repeated again today. We all agree that applicants should be treated with dignity, respect and compassion. And it's important, too, that survivors have access to the Survivor Forum. So I wonder, could the Deputy First Minister indicate how Redress Scotland will ensure that applicants are not re-traumatised, and also what plans the Scottish Government has to continue raising awareness among survivors and families of the scheme during its lifetime?
Deputy First Minister.
There will be an ongoing campaign to make sure awareness is high. We'll obviously be monitoring the pattern of applications, and we have essentially quite a good benchmark from the advance payment scheme of what may well be a reasonable expectation of applications to come forward. We have to make sure that the work that surrounds the Survivor Forum is inclusive, that it gives a platform for survivors to have their input, and I hope what I've said today gives reassurance that the Government is interested on a continual basis to understand, to listen to survivors and to understand how we can support the enhancement of the delivery of the scheme to make the maximum impact on individuals who have suffered in the past.
James Dornan, who joins us remotely, followed by Maggie Chapman.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. I'd like to start off by thanking the Deputy First Minister for all his hard work in getting us to this place, along with the work of many others, of course. But can I ask how the newly appointed panel of 20 experts were selected and what steps were taken to ensure a rigorous recruiting vetting process?
Deputy First Minister.
Sir, can I thank Mr Donner for his kind remarks? It actually prompts me to thank a whole range of civil servants who have worked extraordinarily hard since the passage of this legislation in March to make sure we're at this moment. There's a huge amount of very complex work has been undertaken, and I gave them a timescale which I suspect in civil service parlance was described as heroic, and they have risen to the heroic challenge, and I'm profoundly grateful to all of them for what they have contributed. In relation to the panel of experts on that have been recruited by Redress Scotland, these individuals were recruited through the normal public appointments process of the Scottish Government, so they were subject to a range of scrutiny. I had the pleasure of meeting the first grouping of the panellists in the course of the last couple of weeks, and there is a very broad and diverse range of skills and experience and perspective, including lived experience, which has been brought into the panel, and I think will be well served by these individuals.
Maggie Chapman to be followed by Alexander Stewart.
Thank you. Can I thank the Deputy First Minister for sight of his statement and welcome the opening of the scheme this week. I'd also like to associate myself and my group with his heartfelt words, and I do hope that survivors will continue to feel heard throughout the operation of the scheme. Can I thank him too for the recognition of the importance of providing non-financial redress, such as emotional and therapeutic support? I too would be interested in the information he has agreed to provide to Katie Clark. Can I ask for further details about the arrangements for reviewing the impacts of the waiver during the first 18 months of operation of the scheme? Thank you.
Deputy First Minister.
I think what I should probably do is write to Katie Clark, and I'll place that letter in Spice, just so that all members can have access to that information. In relation to the review of the waiver, I committed during the legislative process to that being undertaken. Indeed, it's part of the legislation. We will obviously, over the course of the 18 months, be gathering information and evidence to support that review on an ongoing basis. We will learn from the experience of individuals about the effect of the waiver, and we will be keen to make sure that we understand and apply that in the review that's undertaken. And obviously, I will be very happy to update Parliament about the progress of that review in due course.
Alexander Stewart, to be followed by Cocab Stewart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I welcome the fact that a Survivors Forum will be established early next year. Can I ask what mechanisms we put in place to ensure that their views and opinions will be acted on, along with any recommendations for improvement? And can the Deputy First Minister provide any further information on when the forum will actually be launched?
Deputy First Minister.
The forum will be launched very swiftly once we begin to build up the engagement with survivors. I want to assure Mr Stewart that the forum will be able to have access to submit its thoughts and its views to Redress Scotland and to the Scottish Government. We have to make sure on an ongoing basis, but back to the point I answered to Mr Mara earlier on, we have to make sure that the voice of survivors is heard loud and clear in this process. If we have failed on that in the past, we cannot fail about that in the future. So that is uppermost in my thinking about how we engage survivors to learn of their perspective on these issues.
Co-Cab Stewart, to be followed by Sarah Boyack.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and thank you to the Deputy First Minister for the clarification on the selection of the panel. Could I ask the DFM how the newly appointed panel of 20 experts will aid in delivering the redress scheme?
Deputy First Minister.
There'll be essentially two elements to that. The panellists will be independently determining the applications, independent of government. So the government will do a lot of the work to prepare applications and to support individuals to be application ready, but the decisions will be taken independently of government in Redress Scotland. The second area is that I think they will be able to bring a really fantastic range of expertise through a number of disciplines: social work, clinical psychology, legal services, and lived experience to the operation of the scheme, and it's important that we hear and understand those messages.
And very briefly, Sarah Boyack.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. Deputy First Minister, is it possible to outline how constituents can apply for support from caseworkers and independent legal support mentioned in the statement? It would be very helpful so that we could signpost that to our constituents.
Deputy First Minister.
Essentially, the contact points that I gave to in my statement will be available for individuals. But what I will do is I will write to all members to provide the necessary information that Sarah Boyack requests. It's alongside the point that Mr Mara made about the importance of there being wide awareness of the scheme. So I'll write to all members very shortly on all of that detail so that can be shared widely by members of Parliament in their local interaction.
Thank you, Deputy First Minister. That concludes this item of business, and we will now move on to the next item of business.